Now, today is auspicious day, you know, to launch this book, because that's the date the PDC was legally established. Now, it is all very funny as far as I'm concerned about the PDC, because when it was first, the law was first introduced in 1968, Lim Chong Eu was a member of the opposition, and he raised so many queries on the law that the then chief minister was worried whether to proceed with the law or not to proceed. And Lim Chong Eu suggested that this be referred to a select committee. And that was the first time they decided to refer to a select committee. And the first meeting of the select committee was in March of 69. And soon after that, Parliament and the state assemblies were all abrogated, so this law lapsed. Now, when he became the chief minister in 1969, I was then the state financial officer, so he asked, we had a talk, and he asked me, we are facing a lot of problems as far as economic development is concerned, and those who will do research or can remember that the Gerakan in its manifesto fought the elections on economic development. So the promises were made and they had to be fulfilled. Whatever a manifesto could not be ignored. So when I told him, this is going to need a lot of staff, but you are in the opposition, and to get the staff approved would be impossible. So we thought whether we should look at the city council, because there the state exco approves the posts. But again, there was a limitation. You could only approve posts where the salary is below 1,000. And again, you have to justify, because the municipal ordinance was very, very strict on how money is spent. So although we created a few posts to help out at the administrative, we realized that there was no way we could get the staff required to push forward ideas for economic development. So I cheekily told him, you know, we got the law that was supposed to be passed, the Development Corporation Act. Why don't we look at it? So he thought about it, and 2 days later said, I think we should do it. And we were very fortunate, that emergency rule, that moment was very fortunate, because there was no state assembly. So all we had to do was to take this law to the State Operations Council. And from the State Operations Council, it was then referred to the National Operations Council, and the law was passed. Of course, when parliamentary democracy was reintroduced, we had to go back to the State Assembly to get it ratified. So the moment we got the law through, then we had to start moving. So they did interviews to get the general manager, and we got a very prominent man, ex-Bank Negara man, who applied, and he accepted the job. But I told Dr. Lim, I said, I don't know whether this man would take up this job. It's a very small job, and he is a very senior man, and I'm sure there are a lot of people waiting for him. Sure enough, that as soon as he had retired, he was offered a job in one of the big banks. So we were left with no general manager, but we from the state administration doubled up. As financial officer, I was a member of the board, and my colleague, Dato Seri Chet, was the state economic officer. So we made him the secretary of the corporation. So for 1 year, we just sat down and planned as what we had to do. Now we realized that with such a high rate of unemployment, 16%, and at that time on the books, there were about 50,000 school leavers looking for jobs. So we thought the best way to do anything for these youngsters in Penang was to industrialize. But in Malaysia then, emphasis had been on import substitution. And our country is so small. Now how can we expand industrialization within the confines of import substitution? So we said the best thing to do is let's do export-oriented industries. So let's see what is happening around the world. So we realized that in Ireland, in Shannon, there was a free trade zone. There was one in Korea. There was one in Taiwan. And they were doing quite well. Of course, Singapore didn't need to have a free trade zone because they were duty-free. So we then decided, okay, let's do this. We had just lost the free port status. So when we went to apply to the KL and say we want to have a free trade zone, the first reaction of the customs department was no. So we asked them, why? You are trying to have a backdoor free port. Because the law what they had then was you can do manufacturing, bulk breaking, trading, this. They said, trading. We cannot agree. So my colleague Amake and I, we were entrusted by Lim Chong Eu, you better go to KL and sort this out. So fortunately for us, for me at that time, the man in charge of tax in the Ministry of Finance was a contemporary of mine in the University of Malaya in Singapore. So when I saw him and spoke to him and explained to him what exactly we wanted, he bought the idea. So we had a meeting, he convened a meeting. And when we sat down for the meeting, the Deputy Director General of Customs came in and he said, I will only be here for 2 minutes because my mandate is to tell you the Royal Customs Department objects to the free port or free trade zone concept. So this chap, Tan Sri Salehuddin, he told you, never mind, we told the secretary, note down that the customs strongly objects. We'll put it in the minutes, but you just sit down and listen and see what this is all about. So we explained to them the concept, and he just sat through it, and then we came back. So I reported to Dr. Lim that this is a bit going to be difficult, you have to take it at your level now. And your level means talking to Letu Razak, Director of Operations, National Operations Council, and see if you can push it through. At that point of time, investment into Malaysia was nil. After May 13, nobody was interested to invest. So I suppose the Letu Razak must have said, or thought, Penang wants to do something, let it do. Let them do it. If they succeed, good for us. If they fail, the blame is theirs. It's a win-win situation. So we had sent papers up to him, so and then we were told that he's visiting Penang. Because as director of National Operations Council, they have to visit us, so he came. We met him at the airport, the old airport. So we drove down, and then the entourage stopped. So he got out of the car, he came up to me. Now, where is your free trade zone? So I said, the free trade zone was around here. So he said, okay. So he called his officers, he called the press, and told Razak is to go with a walking stick that he can use to sit on. So he took the stick, he said, all of you now listen, I am declaring this as a free trade zone. So he told the officers, it has been declared. You now go and finish the paperwork. So, as far as the customs were concerned, they were quite annoyed. But under the emergency rule, who is going to object? So that solved the biggest headache we had. After that, it was up to us to prove that the concept of free trade zone can work. Now, in these initial stages, Dr. Lim Chong Eu, on his own, was making contacts with people he knew. And he had a wide range of contacts in different countries. And they were all quite happy and willing to want to help him. And so he said, we have got to show that we are very serious. So we instructed the JKR, I want 3 temporary buildings. I think if you drive to the airport, you can still see one wooden building. 10,000 square feet. And I want these buildings to be built in 12 weeks. The engineer, JKR said, we cannot do it. He said, there's no such thing. It must be done within 12 weeks. And he made an announcement, I'm going to build it. The timeline given was, you have to show people you are serious. You mean business. Otherwise, it's just like politicians keep on talking. This is going to happen, or that is going to happen. He said, you have to show people that what you say is going to be done. So, thank God, by the 11th week, buildings were ready. So, and then, of course, he made a speech that we are going to create jobs for 50,000 people. And you have to remember then, we had the local newspaper, not the Star, the State's Echo. So State's Echo headlines, Chief Minister predicts 50,000 jobs. And at the same time, we had the federal government committee chaired by the late K. Jory and Tun Tan Susin looking for investments. So Tun Tan Susin was here. So on the way to the airport, he said he wanted to look at the buildings put up. So we were asked as officers, go and meet him there. So when we were there, he had his MCA supporters and the press. We went in, it's only a 10,000 square feet building. He said, look, this is where they're going to have 50,000 workers. So I looked at him, I said, shook my head. But my assistant colleague, Amar K, he was a little bit more hot-blooded. He wanted to go up and confront him. I said, no, dear. He said, I said, let them, I think people are sensible to realize when we talk 50,000 jobs, it doesn't mean in this building. Now, when we build the building for a specific purpose, because we wanted to demonstrate 2 things. One is to introduce electronics. So we thought if we have this building, we will get some people to come in and we will assemble radios. So that people will know something is happening. Number two, if investors come in, we got buildings to tell them, look, you want to do your training, you can do it free of charge. Rent this, no charge. You bring in your own equipment and you start. So we started Penang Electronics producing radios. It was just simple. Now when you look at it with today's standard of EE and all this, that was all child's play. But you'll be surprised that being an opposition governed state, the Economist magazine carried two columns. Chief Minister of Penang, Dr. Lim Chong Eu, embarked a program for electronics and starts a radio this, and he got good publicity. And to imagine the cost of getting such publicity in the Economist. My PDC budget didn't have the money to put an advertisement in the Economist. This gave us a free. That was the background of the beginning. Now, once the PDC was started, we then realized we had a lot of freedom on recruitment and don't have to go follow government procedures. And that time, I must quote this, the late Tun Razak wanted to create statutory bodies because the government departments cannot do many things. So he made a statement, statutory bodies have to be created to combine certain principles, public ownership, a broad but not too detailed public accountability, a consciousness that they are working in the national interest, together with a liveliness and initiative which are associated with an enterprising and progressive business concern. Their existence is justified only if they have in fact carried out national objectives, combined at the same time because of relative freedom they enjoy in their day-to-day management. Now, this statement was, as far as Lim Chong Eu was concerned, was a beautiful statement. It gave him, from here to here, freedom. Because it's all in the interest, national interest, combining the best private sector initiatives. So he said, in the private sector, they recruit people on the basis of merit. There'll be no race, no creed, no religion. So we recruited a whole lot of young people. Now, one of them sitting here, well now of course after 50 years they look old. This gave the state of Penang the flexibility to move ahead so that you can take decisions and not wait and look whether somebody is going to approve it or not. Now, in order to do that, you have to have a visionary. Not everybody can do it. You can put 100 people and 99 will fail. But you needed somebody like Lim Chong Eu, who hardly slept, working all the time, and full of ideas. So you need an institution that has no red tape. So when we talk and want to look back on the progress made by Penang as far as industrialization is concerned, you cannot discount the fact that had he not created the PDC, we wouldn't have achieved this. Because, and I can tell you, because when I was in the state administration, a state financial officer, we also had in the state administration, Industrial Estates Committee. And that was responsibility of one assistant secretary. So there was nothing much, it wasn't a full time. But with PDC, this became our life. And the staff were so imbued by the enthusiasm of Lim Chong Eu that I must say they worked very passionately. And we were not paid very well, you know. Of course, under the corporation, we could have paid ourselves more. But Lim Chong Eu said, for every dollar you save, at that time the development costs were cheap, you will develop 1 square foot. So he told me, which is better? To pay all these fellows $10 more, or I get 100 square feet of land? The need of the state is far more important than this. You will enjoy the benefits in a different way. What you do in the future, people will recognize it. Of course, now 50 years later, we can say, yeah, now everybody is talking about PDC. But at that time, people would have said, we want money. But I think, in a sense, I used to tell my staff, either we are mad or a little bit foolish, that we are not fighting for more salary. But I think the situation then was such that you would feel a bit ashamed to ask for this material when the state was in a real mess. In 1968, the chairman of the International Chamber of Commerce gave a speech, and next day headlines say, Seco, Penang doomed to be a fishing village. And every businessman you met, all the thing is, why don't you fight for free port? Retain the free port. Actually, if you think of it, had we the free port, I don't think it would have helped us to reach what we are today. It was a blessing that Tun Tan Siew Sin took away the free port and gave us the opportunity to think that you can have other options. Of course, now you can use the term thinking outside the box. But at my time then, there was no phrase like thinking out of the box. Maybe we were thinking out of our brains. Because actually most people said, you create these free trade zones, you're going to fail. And I think that's why I use the word mad, because if there was no streak of madness, passion, I don't think this would have happened. And all that was brought about by a man who had the leadership qualities. And he had a vision. And I could see him dealing with the young staff, and he could motivate them to such an extent that they believed that they could think more than what they honestly felt they could think. Sometimes I thought maybe he had a magic aura, you know, just, and people were. But the time at that point, you needed somebody like Lim Chong Eu to shake out of the state and get going. And when he found he was being obstructed somewhere, he used the PDC too. And his relationship during the emergency period with federal leaders helped once parliamentary democracy was restored. We had, today we got MIDA, then we had FIDA. FIDA also was growing. We were about the same time. So with the efforts we made, contact foreign investors, MIDA in some sense rode on our tailcoats. So we all became good friends with MIDA officers in the sense that they needed us and we needed them. And they also realized that when they brought investors into this country, servicing investors, they found us to be very good. And of course, they were also pretty clever. They will send the investors to Penang over the weekend. They don't want to deal with them over the weekend in KL. On Friday evening, they'll tell them, take a flight, go to Penang. And they'll come here and stay on Friday night, Saturday night, Sunday night. We had to work throughout the weekend. And Tun Lim Chong Eu enjoyed working this. And he will entertain them, talk to them, and if you had a chance to be in any of these sessions, you'll be wondering, how can this one man know so much about so many things? And the investors were all very impressed. You think he can go there and pick up a flower, or think he can give you an hour's lecture on that plant. And you can take a look at a fish. His knowledge was tremendous. Of course, they had setbacks, because at the state level, people won't talk. So they say, why is it these people don't talk? I said, so I could only talk to him, because when we had a discussion in the evening, he was very generous with his Johnny Walker. So with a few Johnny Walkers, I was also very brave. So I told him, he wouldn't allow us to call him sir. He said, you want to call me, you call me. So one of the staff said, call boss. No, boss reminds you of the days of slavery. You can call me chief. So with that, I said, chief, you know why people don't talk? You behave like the chief architect, chief engineer, chief botanist. What do you want people to do? Give them a chance. But then again, he sometimes knew more than us, because he reads. But that was good for the PDC staff, who were very young, because they're fresh out of university, is a challenge to them. So the rapport created by interaction built a very fantastic team within PDC, led by the chief coach, Lim Chong Eu. And it was like playing, you know, like today football, you know, this great Messi and Suarez and all. They know he's going to kick the ball there and he's run there. So in the PDC, they managed to get a rapport between Chong Eu and the staff. And he made it a point to interact not only with me, but the rest of the staff. He wants this, he'll go and find who's the officer dealing with it. Let's talk. That was something I don't think you find anywhere. There was no protocol, no nothing. And he told us, you don't worry about the politics. That is my business. You just do your work. But if you're corrupt, I will be with the anti-corruption agency to go for you. Don't look to me and say, please help me. So I think what we have achieved in 20 years and what we see as a, I would say, as a spillover continuation is the mainly through the vision of Lim Chong Eu and the Penang Development Corporation, who managed to keep pace with Lim Chong Eu's thinking. And it would have been difficult had it been a state administration, because you get the staff changes, transfers and all, whereas here it was a dedicated group of people with a focus of taking Penang forward. I won't go into what were the functions of the PDC, what were we supposed to do, the goals. You pay $35, buy the book and read it. I was given about 20 minutes. I think I exceeded that. And I hope you'll read the book. You'll see that there are two chapters on industrialization. And when we were writing this book, compiling, we decided that we will get some people who are not within the PDC to write on industrialization, so that you will get an outside view. One is by, I think, Hutchinson. Now, Hutchinson was doing his PhD. And for his PhD, he decided to, his topic was Penang and Bangalore, how they could achieve industrial development at a state level. So you'll know, and his, what he thinks of was done in Penang. And then there was a professor from the National University of Canberra who was also doing research on industrial hubs. And he was fascinated with what Penang achieved. So these two write-ups will show you that in our own way, we managed to hit the right ingredients and achieve success. We ourselves were not specialists. It was so happened we were there and were fortunate to have achieved something successful. In fact, before we started, Lim Chong Eu told me, this is a situation where you and I have to jump into the pond. If we cannot swim and come out, you die. If we come out, either we'll be just wet and nothing achieved, but if we come out successfully and then able to continue, then people will talk of what we have done, or what PDC has done. And today I'm very happy, Bazit, you are there. You're in your 50th year. I feel very fortunate that I can see PDC's 50th year. Yeah? So with that, thank you very much. And if there are any questions, I'll try and answer, but you have to remember, I'm trying to remember, and his age has gone, caught up with me. Although I know my good friend, Dato Seri Devraj, much older than me, and is more active than me. But I'll try my best to answer whatever you want. Thank you very much.